Welcome, 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 everybody, to another of my charmingly chaotic book talks, the only show that imagines movies based on not one, but two books, like The Joyluck Fight Club or The Island of Dr. Zhivago. Give me a name drop, will you, Morgan? Thank you kindly. That's the closest thing I have to a business card. And for all you first-time viewers out there, I'm Steven, constant reader, librarian at Cinco Ranch Branch in Katy, and man seen here finding $11 in his dryer. I spent the rest of that day interviewing investment advisors. I mean, a little financial advice goes a long way, right? Oh, come on. That was one time. I'm a fan of Golden Age genre fiction as much as the next guy. What? No. I don't know what he's talking about. But the writers of those bygone days didn't always do justice when it came to gender and racial equality. This was especially true of influential writer and man seen here hiding a frog in his mouth, H.P. Lovecraft, who is best known for his underdeveloped characters, his overblown vocabulary with a bizarre predilection for words like eldritch and cyclopean. And of course, Cthulhu and his chums who drive people insane just by giving them a funny look. But Lovecraft was also notorious for his narrow-minded views. And his ideas about inferior races come across in his stories to varying degrees. Today, a handful of novels have endeavored to rectify this, including the novel of today's book talk, Lovecraft Country, an ingenious blend of historical fiction and pulp horror that ties Lovecraft's paranormal milieu with a bookish African-American family living in a twisted mid-century America where cosmic monsters are real, but the racism is the real monster. Author Matt Ruff, seen here waiting for his Uber ride, sets this novel in the 1950s when the Jim Crow South still had its hooks in the lives of African Americans all across the country. The book opens with Korean War vet Atticus Turner making a risky road trip from Florida to Chicago, where he discovers his estranged father Montrose has been missing for several days, last seen in the company of a strange man. The only clue to Montrose's whereabouts points to somewhere in rural Massachusetts, where Lovecraft set most of his stories. Atticus, along with his childhood friend Letty and other members of the Turner family, embark on a perilous journey to recover their missing patriarch. And following a series of unfortunate events that Lemony Snicket himself couldn't foresee, our heroes soon realize that they bear an ominous connection to a family of white wizards. I should clarify, not KKK wizards, but the devil-worshipping kind. And this cabal of sorcerers is hell-bent on using a Lovecraftian ritual to wrest power from the elder gods and cement their position here on Earth. Because when has it not worked out for rich old white guys who assume their wealth and privilege will protect them from the ancient horrors of the cosmos? Matt Ruff imbues the narrative with a number of Lovecraftian hallmarks. Secretive cults, haunted houses, shapeless horrors lurking in the shadows, gateways to distant planets. But that's hardly the novel's most disturbing elements. The real nightmare fuel lies in the systemic racism and hateful violence perpetrated by monsters that are all too human. Like early in the novel, when Atticus is pulled over and needlessly harassed by a bigoted cop, you can't help but feel the injustice of the situation. Matt Ruff partially modeled this novel from a real-life travel guide called the Negro Motorist Green Book that was used by African-American travelers to safely navigate the U.S. Lovecraft Country features a fictionalized version of said book, which is used by members of the Turner family to avoid the dreaded sundown towns that prohibited the presence of persons of color after dark. I'm sure by this point, some of you are thinking, this book is simply a sobering sermon on the evils of racism. Au contraire, While yes, the novel illustrates how institutional racism is just as weird and terrifying as anything Mr. Lovecraft could have dreamed up, however, Matt Ruff masterfully straddles the line between social commentary and pleasurable storytelling without ever forgetting that the book's foremost job is to entertain. Lovecraft Country is surprisingly hilarious and often riveting. Outside of Stephen King, rarely in the horror genre do you find protagonists as engaging as this. If the cunning heroics of the Turner family don't have you pumping your fists in elation, then seek professional help immediately. But don't just take my word for it. Lovecraft Country will seize your attention from page one and take you along on what Seven Eves author Neal Stephenson has declared a funny, fast, exciting, and affecting read. The structure of this novel is an interesting one, and I'd be remiss not to talk about it here. Lovecraft Country comprises a series of tightly interconnected chapter stories that advance a master narrative. It's simultaneously a short story collection and a novel. Each chapter plays out like a Monster of the Week episode of Buffy or Supernatural, following a different character as they get sucked into this warped version of New England. Matt Ruff's clean, no-frills prose keeps the tension simmering without losing steam, relying on character development and ambiance to do most of the heavy lifting. The best way to describe Matt Ruff's writing style is that it's light on frivolity, but just detailed enough to paint a vivid picture. The book's episodic nature makes it ripe for adaptation, which comes as no surprise that at the time of this recording, the book has been translated into a visually intoxicating HBO series spearheaded by underground writer Misha Green. I just finished watching the show, and it is phenomenal, with a stellar cast that boasts acting treasures Michael Kenneth Williams, Courtney B. Vance, and Regina Taylor. But getting back to the book, Lovecraft Country was a late entry into my oh dear god, I already have so much to read pile. In retrospect, I'm glad I was able to squeeze this book into my already jam-packed reading schedule. It's culturally relevant, and it's all the best genres wrapped up in one oh-so-lovely package. Fans of Matt Ruff's imaginative and offbeat fiction will definitely want to check out The Ballad of Black Tom, which also portrays African-Americans entrapped in occult schemes in the first half of the 20th century. Great book. It's also where I keep my Whiskey Makes Me Frisky flask. So now that you've listened to me going on and on about Lovecraft Country, I want to hear what you think. Let me know if you enjoyed the book. What are your thoughts on the HBO series, and how does it stack up against the book? As always, leave your comments right down there. And don't forget to like and subscribe to show your love and support. Thank you for watching, and as always, stay true to your shelves.